On? Okay. All right, good evening, everybody, again. Sorry for the delay, but we're not going to be able to do YouTube Live. So we'll just go ahead and get in. We already opened up with prayer. So we're going to be in Revelation chapter 15 tonight. And it's, I don't know why I find it surprising that these chapters are as short as they are for, I mean, the depth of importance of this book. It's not really a long book, but it's packed with obviously necessary and good information for us. So last week, we kind of looked at, in chapter 14, I think in that chapter, it addresses the resurrection of the saints, the return of Christ. He comes to Mount Zion, he stands on Mount Zion, and preparing the world for his reign. And one thing to mention again about Revelation is it's not chronological. What John does is he kind of goes back and forth with the scenes that he's seeing. I kind of picture like he's got this a panoramic view of God's plan from beginning to end, and he's kind of seeing all of it. I forget which chapter it was, but he even talked about the birth of Messiah, you know, obviously going back to that, and then the prophecies concerning that, and then moves forward to how that ties in with all of this. So we're kind of getting a glimpse of the overall picture, and he's just pointing out important things. So in chapter 15, this is after the resurrection. Those that remain on the earth now are, in my view, and I know there's differences of opinion on this, and I'm only going to give you my view. My view is that the church is resurrected. I don't believe that all the saints are raised up at that time. I do think that there are still saved people on the earth during this time. And yes, I also believe that there are going to be some saved people who will have to face what we see in chapter 15 as the wrath of God, God's judgment on the earth. And we'll see why I think that. I know there's two different positions, actually several different positions. I guess the opposite position of that is that all of the saved are raptured or resurrected when Christ returns. And I don't see that to be the case. And we talked about that prior to this point. And we'll also talk about it again when we get to chapter 20, the differences of resurrections, the differences of judgments. I believe that at this time, the bride is resurrected. Those that are alive are caught up together with him, as 1 Corinthians describes. And then the dead in Christ actually precede the catching away of the saints, but the dead in Christ rise first. The dead in Christ rise first. I don't think that necessarily means all of the saved. So if you've never heard that view before and you're watching on YouTube as we post this, at least consider it. If I'm wrong, then hey, guess what? All the saved are raised up. And I will gladly admit my error to you in the kingdom. So it's well worth studying and kind of formulating your own ideas. One thing I've learned over the years is not just to accept something because somebody says it. Even if it's a beloved pastor that you have or a teacher that you look up to. Men aren't perfect. You know, they make mistakes. I've known men who have studied the Word of God for years, decades even, and have changed their mind, their view on some of these things. So study for yourself. I think that's really the important thing, but stick to what the Word of God says. You know, try to minimize commentaries and views of those, you know, over the Word of God. So let's get into chapter 15. It's not a long chapter. There's only 8 verses. So we'll definitely finish all this tonight as we go through this. So verse 1, John writing here, he says, I saw another sign in heaven, or maybe better, the heavens again. Another sign in the heavens, great and marvelous. So these are spectacular things that he's seeing. Again, we see the number 7 with 7 angels this time, having the 7 last plagues. For in them is filled up the wrath of God. And that kind of reminds me of Egypt. When God judged Egypt with the 10 plagues at that time, of course the last one being the death of the firstborn, and then the miraculous deliverance of the children of Israel out of Egypt. And then of course they became the nation of Israel after that point. And there's a link to that in here. We're going to see in just a moment where there's a couple of songs that are sung by those that are resurrected. And there's a beautiful verse 3 is a beautiful verse. But there's a couple of songs that are sung. One of them is the Song of Moses, and it has to do with the deliverance of God's people out of Egypt. And that was that deliverance, as real as it was in a physical sense, where there was a mighty deliverance physically, it pictured a lot of things as we know. It pictured salvation, applying the blood of Christ and being saved. It pictures baptism, going through the Red Sea, and as we're baptized in water, you know, we're leaving this world behind and we're following Christ. So there's a lot of pictures there. And even with the reality of our pictures of the salvation we experience by faith in Christ, baptism, and becoming a part of the New Testament church, as real as that is, that's still symbolic. This is the real. I mean, at this time in chapter 15 and all of these events that are unfolding, this is the reality. This is when our faith becomes sight. So, you know, the burial we did with our life and baptism, separating ourselves from this world, the reality is we're really going to be set apart from this world, and we're called to unite with Christ, and that's going to be a glorious thing. And what's, I guess it's interesting, is that John doesn't really address the resurrection itself so much, but clearly that takes place. We saw it back in chapter 14 last week. Well, where was that? Oh, verse 15, where it says, another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to them that to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in thy sickle and reap, for the time has come for thee to reap, and the harvest of the earth is ripe. And this is the reality of God calling out his people from this world. So all of those that have prepared themselves, they're saved, they're baptized, they're faithfully following Christ the best they can, not perfectly. Nobody has ever followed Christ perfectly, but they have their sins forgiven. They focus on him. They leave the cares of this world behind. And for these end time saints, which is going to be addressed, they are maybe more than any other generation of saints. They've really faced Satan's onslaught with the mark of the beast, with the beast himself, with the man of sin, all of these things coming to full fruition, and it's challenging for God's people, but they overcame. Hopefully that's us. We overcame, and hopefully we're overcoming that. So those are the ones that have made this harvest ripe. It's time for this season. Now, I've never been a farmer. I've thought about, you know, planting a little garden in my backyard, growing some stuff, maybe corn and radishes, tomatoes. My dad tried growing green beans in our backyard. It worked. We had a little harvest at the end of summer of some green beans we were able to eat. We had some corn. But, you know, you plant it, and you, as it starts to grow, you nourish it, you water it, you tend to it as it grows, and then the harvest comes. And the picture we have here is that's what God has been doing with his people all of this time, nourishing, and now the harvest is ripe. And this is the end. At this point, this is the end of this age. Just a real quick digression for a moment. And I'm even going to address this a little bit on Sunday morning in the message. But the church here probably heard me mention a couple of times about the different transitions. Transitional periods. There's Eden, flood, and this. There's three great transitional periods where life from one moment into the next is never the same. So think about the Garden of Eden. We don't know how long they were there. It was perfect. They had fellowship with God. Everything was great. And then sin entered the picture, and God had to kick them out. What that life was like, none of us will ever know until Christ returns. But Adam and Eve's life was completely different, never to go back to that Garden of Eden experience physically. Then from that time until the flood, I compare it to that because for 1,500 and some years, man lived on the earth, and it was wonderful. It was a different world than we know it now, in almost every way, environmentally, just in so many ways. The earth itself looked quite different before the flood than it does now. So the flood comes, and when Noah and his family got into the ark, and when they got off the ark, it was a different world that they lived in. Now, it's been in that era since the flood until now. And there's been some transitions in that time. God called his people out of Egypt. Christ came, established his church. But now is the next transition. And you know, I think a lot of Christians are thinking about this now, and maybe rightly so. But it seems to me that we can expect the soon return of Christ, possibly within our lifetime. And that should create those emotions that we've talked about, that fear and great joy. You know, on the one hand, it's like, wow, this could be it. But then on the other hand, wow, this is what we've been expecting. This is what we want. But what that means is life as we know it now will never be the same. The things that we do, everything we know about this world is not going to be the same when Christ returns. One of the verses I'm going to address on Sunday morning, and then kind of quickly transition into another point I want to make, is that it says that when Christ returns, it'll be the restoration of all things. God's going to restore the earth, probably to the close to the pre-flood time. That's exciting to me. But at the same time, it's kind of not frightening, like afraid, but awestruck, like, wow, you know, this could be happening. If I'm wrong, could be my son's generation, could be my granddaughter's, my grandson's generation, could be my great-grandkids. We don't know, but we know it's going to happen. The fact is, there's going to be a generation of saints living when it does happen. And all indicators now are looking like the world's being set up. So, again, that's exciting for us. So, back to this. These last plagues, Christ has come, called out his bride. Now God's going to judge the world. There's other verses I could go to about that, but I don't really want to address that, at least not at this setting. In verse 2, he writes, I saw as it were. I think those words are chosen because he's seeing signs and symbols, and he describes it as he sees it. It's a spiritual picture, but as it were, he sees a sea of glass mingled with fire. We've already established that in Revelation, the sea oftentimes represents humanity. And in this case, it seems like it represents the bride, the chosen ones that were called out. I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire. The fire could represent judgment. They've been refined. And them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name. These were standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. That's just a beautiful vision to me. I think I said verse 3 earlier, but that's just a beautiful image of those that overcome standing on this sea. Perhaps the sea wasn't them, but this whatever the sea is, it's mingled with fire, and they're standing on top of it, these overcomers that Revelation has already talked about. And these are the ones that got the victory over the beast. I'm going to read this again, because these are pretty intense things. The beast, we talked about him a little bit. We're going to talk about the beast even more in the coming Revelation studies, in chapters 16, 17, and even 18. So over the beast, over his image. God doesn't like images. Going way back to the very beginning, idolatry, anything that's set up as an image to worship, God does not like. So this is a highly intense image. We know the beast to be Satan, the working of Satan. So it's an image of Satan, his power, his work, over his mark. We had an interesting discussion on that a few months ago as we talked about the mark. It seems that somehow it's connected with the ability to buy and sell. That seems obvious. Some people think it's a microchip. They used to think, as we talked about, social security number, driver's license, all those things. And all those things, I think, are part of it. But really, ultimately, the mark of the beast is those whose hearts and their minds are given over to this world and its work rather than over to God and his work. God has his own mark as well. He has his own mark on his people. And his people are identified not by anything significant about their appearance. I grew up in a house that had a family Bible on our coffee table. And when I was a little kid, I used to look at the pictures in it, because it had some pictures. But all of the saints, all the people, the big names like David and Moses and Abraham, they all had halos over their head. You could identify who the people of God were because they had this halo over their heads. And I forget, when it finally dawned on me that there's no halo. You can't see something over somebody's head. But you identify them by their life, by their speech, the way they act and react, the way they live. They follow God. They follow Christ. That's the identifying mark. And Satan has his. And the more we get into this, as we get to the end, there's going to be a division, a divide. And I think we understand this. It's pretty clear that not every saved person is wholly given over to following Christ. And even we experience that ourselves. We're not always wholly given over as we should. We need to grow and work on it. I've been doing this for a long time. I've been saved since I was 21. So that was a long time ago. I don't know how many years ago that was. I could figure it out. But a long time ago. I hope I've grown since that time. I'd hate to think that I'm still at that level spiritually as when I was first saved. I think we all can relate to that. But these ones are the ones that overcome. Not every child of God overcomes. They give themselves over to this flesh, this world, its system. So the number of his name, these will stand on the sea of glass having harps. That's one of the instruments that I would love to learn to play. So I plan on being in this group. So I better start practicing the harp. I would imagine we're going to be given special ability at that time to praise God in this way. But verse 3 says, and they sang the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous. It seems to me like the song of Moses is found in Exodus chapter 15. Let's look at it really quick before we actually sing the song that they're going to sing. Exodus 15. And it's no accident that this is the song that was sung after they were delivered out of Egypt and saw the mighty work of God. So starting in verse 1, in Exodus chapter 15, then sang Moses and the children of Israel. We're not going to read the whole thing. I just want to kind of get a feel of it. This song unto the Lord. And they spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord. Can you imagine seeing that? I mean, they just got through witnessing this. And they're praising God. The Lord is my strength and song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him a habitation, my father's house, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his host hath he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also he drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. And if you like watching documentaries, they're coming across archaeological evidence of these things in the region where this took place. Egyptian chariots, horses, bones and hoofs, remains in the Red Sea. So it was an actual event. And clearly, skeptics will try to, give natural reasoning as to how that happened, that miraculous event, by saying, it wasn't the Red Sea, it was the Reed Sea. They walked through on water that was probably about a foot or so deep. And That's not true. Even if it was, it's pretty miraculous how the Israeli people, the Jewish people, got through where it says they walked on dry ground in the Bible. But then if that is true, that it was just like a foot deep, all the Egyptians drowned. This mighty army of people drowned in a foot of water. So they never accepted it as just a natural event. It was miraculous to them. When I was preparing for this, it occurred to me, and probably it should occur to me more intense a long time ago, but if we watch, we see some pretty miraculous things by God. How he does things that just, there's no explanation of how it happens. Just think about your life and some of the events in your life, how God has moved. You know, not just maybe in a natural sense, like, you know, with your job or whatever. But even with that, there are some things that, you know, we see God's hand in. I've experienced that even recently with a job change. I think back to prior to that, you know, I believe with all of my heart that meeting my wife was not an accident. You know, I think back to how everything worked out. You know, it wasn't chance. It was by design, by God. So we see that personally in our lives, but we also see it corporately as the Lord works through his church. So the song that they sung, I just wanted to give us a flavor of it, what it sounds like. The song of the song of the Lamb. We saw one of those. There's actually a couple of places where it references that, but let's look at Revelation 5. I think both of those could be probably called the Song of the Lamb. Both events, Moses and what we're considering, Revelation 5, and starting in verse 9. This is those beasts and others in the heavens singing praises to God. And this is the song that they sing. It says that at the last part of verse 8. Let's read verse 8. It says, "When he had taken the book, the four beasts and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred, the tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth." And so these two songs are referenced, and they're both alluding to the same thing. God called his people out of Egypt at that time for them to actually reign on the earth under his authority. They were a theocracy. They were the only spiritual kingdom on the world. All others were heathen. They tried to imitate some things that God did. They tried to steal some of God's means, you know, the Ark of the Covenant. They tried to copy things, but it's all for nothing. God's people were the ones that were reigning on the earth at that time, of course, through him. And that was just temporary, because it was to be that way. But of course, the God of this world, Satan, oftentimes intervened and battled with God's people for control over this physical world. And Satan, God gives Satan free rein to do things. So he'll restrain him sometimes so that God's will can be accomplished. And by the way, a little plug for this coming Sunday's message. And I kind of hesitated. I gave it a title of "Has the Beast Been Released?" And I've said, in fact, I even posted this when I put in our Facebook advertising for Sunday, that this is the most important message I've ever preached. That doesn't mean it's going to be the best. That doesn't mean it's the most important. And I really hesitated as I'm studying it, bringing some things out, because really, it matters if the time is right. Because there's going to come a point where the beast is let go, and he's going to have full reign on the earth. And part of the question is, has that happened? And it seems like right now, Satan has his tentacles throughout all of the governments, all in almost every area of society, public education, health systems, government, financial, religious. His power is working its way throughout the whole world. And I think United States was sort of one of the last regions on earth where God allowed, or he withheld, Satan's full power so that the church could spread as it has. The gospel could be preached freely as it has. And that's changing. I don't know if he's been released or not. All I know is that Satan is the god of this world. Even Jesus himself pointed that out. But make no mistake about it, God's people, his people will reign on this earth. Not in this flesh, but when he returns, that is our purpose. So if you don't plan on reigning in the kingdom of God, then don't worry about following him. Don't worry about the things in the scriptures. You may be saved. I'm speaking generally because I know there's more people watching than just us here, so don't think I'm talking to you. But you know, if you really don't plan on reigning with Christ for 1,000 years and even into eternity, then don't worry about what the Bible says. You know, if you're confident that you've been delivered from hell and you're fine with that, then by all means, live life as you want. But understand this, you'll be judged for that. God created man to rule on this earth. That was Adam's position. So it's going to come. Christ, the second Adam, will rule this earth, and he has a bride. I guess we'll call his bride his Eve. They will rule together. They will be one, ruling together on this earth. Okay, let's continue this. Okay, verse 4. These, it says, who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name, for thou art holy, for all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest. Does the New King James say anything different in verse 4, where it says, for thou art holy? Okay, you alone are holy. Okay. I thought there was a different word in some translations. Maybe not. I might be mistaken. Okay, verse 5. After that I looked, and behold, the temple. And this is fascinating as well. And as I read this, because this is kind of where my mind went with this. John's seeing a heavenly vision. He sees the temple, which we know the temple, the real temple, is the body of Christ, his church. While the church was on the earth, each church was a temple, wherever it was located. All the independent, local, visible, autonomous bodies of Christ were a temple of God, but collectively they're the temple in heaven. We read in Ephesians, I always point this out, but there's at least 6 times where Paul writes to the Ephesus church that he mentions the heavenly places. We're seated in heavenly places. So we are the temple. We're representing Christ on the earth right now. And now John sees, and John was familiar with that, the temple in the metaphorical sense of the body of Christ. He says, after that I looked and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. I wish he would have been given more of a glimpse of what that was like. That had to be glorious. This is not like Solomon's temple, which we're going to look at some things about that in just a moment. But Solomon's temple, at that time, of all of the religious buildings, places of worship, places of sacrifice, and every nation had them, Solomon's outshined them all because it was God's temple. And even though it was just made of stone and other earthly materials, it represented something heavenly. And of course, that didn't last. It was destroyed. A second temple was built. Again, it was magnificent. It was glorious. And then, of course, that was destroyed. It seems there's going to be another temple built during these end time periods. And by the way, that's another indicator that things are moving and shaking over there in Israel, Jerusalem, to build another temple. But that temple's nothing. It's not the real temple is his church. But it pictures what John sees here. So it must have been a magnificent vision. But it was opened in heaven. This says in verse 6, the seven angels came out of the temple, having the seven plagues, clothed in pure and white linen, and having their breasts girded with golden girdles. I've said this often over the years, but as the church on any given Sunday morning or Wednesday evening, whenever the church assembles together, it's a heavenly place. I think it's a Bible study, we're church members here, I believe God's presence is with us as we assemble together. But it's heavenly. It's spiritual. We don't see a thing, though. But I think if we could see things as John sees, I think we would see God, I may be kind of goofy here, but God with a smile on his face being pleased with what we're doing right now. And I would think even if we were to go till 10:01, that's the magic time when we must be home. If we were to go till 10:01, I think God would still have a smile on his face. Even if this lasted until the wee hours of the morning and Governor Newsom is having a heart attack because we're gathered together here, God has a smile on his face. Because what we're doing is right. This is good. We're honoring God. So I think there's angelic beings that are here among us. Certainly, I believe the Holy Spirit is guiding us and to understand these things as we try to figure out what this is all talking about. But make no mistake about it, it's even though we don't see things physically, the Lord's church and this work is a glorious work. I want to go to 2 Chronicles. When Solomon did build the temple, actually when he finished it. Of course, if you know the story, you know that David was the one that assembled all the material. He wanted so desperately to build a house for God, but he was not permitted to. His son, however, was. So Solomon took the material that was arranged by David. I think we see a very beautiful picture there in that symbolism of John the Baptist preparing the material and then Jesus coming along and assembling the temple, the church. But in its physical sense here, chapters 5, 6, and 7 talk about the preparation. Chapter 6, I'm not going to take the time to read the prayer, but of all the amazing prayers in the scriptures, read chapter 6, Solomon's prayer as he finished the temple. It's beautiful. Certainly God was pleased with Solomon's prayer and what he did. Now in chapter 7, verse 1, it says, when Solomon had made an end of praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. Isn't that amazing? I don't know what Solomon saw. I don't know what this fire looked like, but it was glorious. And just as that scene we saw in the heavens with the glory that was there, God filling the temple in the heavens, the angels coming out of the temple and doing their work on this earth, this is not even comparable to that, and yet look at the glory that was here. And of course, while I'm reading this, I'm not going to really go into it. We just got through talking about it on Sunday mornings, the day of Pentecost, when the church was empowered with the Holy Spirit. God's glory filled the temple, and miraculous things happened. They spoke with tongues, they did miracles, and the world was changed because of that event, of course, because of Christ, but it was a glorious event. And this filling is just as glorious. This identified this temple as God's temple, and it separated it from every other temple that was in existence on the earth. Then it says the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. When all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord was upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. That, after seeing that, I know that's an amazing statement, for he is good. But it seems almost like not enough. I mean, after witnessing that, to say God is good, what else could you say, though? God is good. His mercy endures forever. Then the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. And King Solomon offered a sacrifice of 20 and 2,000 oxen. This didn't happen in one day, I don't think. This wasn't just an hour-long service. I wonder if, after the first, oxen was offered, maybe the hour goes by and people are sitting back, okay, come on, is this going to be over with? We got to watch a football game or something. But, we take our service to God so casually on Sunday mornings. Like, we'd go there, I'm not saying, again, not talking to any of you, just in general, but people do their time, and I know how people are. Sometimes they're sitting there thinking about the game that starts at 1 o'clock, their favorite team or whatever. It wasn't like that in this case. They did not care how long this was taking. I think this was several days on end when all of this took place. Just a quick side note. I think if this is real, if what's happening is really preparing us for the soon return of Christ, I think we need to rethink how we serve God. Maybe give it a little bit more importance than we do. Because the fact is, nothing else is going to matter in the end. We're not taking anything that we have with us. And somehow Satan has fooled everybody to think that, we're going to take all this stuff with us. This is going to last forever. In this world, there's only a few things that are everlasting. One is your salvation. Two is the Lord's church. Everything else is temporary. Your flesh, the building we meet in, it's all temporary. Okay. The king and all the people will offer sacrifices. Oh, I read that. So he dedicated the house of God, offering 22,000 sheep. That's a lot of sheep. And the priests waited on their offices. And the Levites, also with instruments of music of the Lord, which David the king had made to praise the Lord, because his mercy endures forever. I meant to count how many times we read that phrase, endures forever. And when David praised, by their ministry, and the priests sounded the trumpets before them, all of Israel stood. Moreover, Solomon hallowed the middle of the court, and it was before the house of the Lord. For there he offered burnt offerings, for the fat of the peace offerings, great, because the brazen altar which Solomon had made was not able to receive the burnt offerings and the meat offerings and the fat. I want to read a few more verses. I want to get down to one of the most famous verses in the scriptures. Also, at the same time, Solomon kept the feast 7 days, and all Israel with him. A very great congregation from the entering of Hamath unto the river Egypt, and the eighth day they made solemn assembly, for they kept the dedication of the altar 7 days, and the feast 7 days. And on the 23rd day of the seventh month, he sent the people away to their tents, glad and merry in heart, for the goodness that the Lord had showed unto David and to Solomon and to Israel his people. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord and the king's house and all that came into Solomon's heart to make in the house of the God and his own house he prosperously effected. I'm having trouble talking for some reason. Verse 12, the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer, and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. That's a wonderful response to his prayer. I have heard thy prayer. I wish we had the ability to audibly hear God after our prayers. I hear you. But we have the assurance that our prayers are heard, and our prayers are attended to, especially, I'll say this, because the Lord points this out, especially in this place, the temple of God. That place was holy, it was special. In the world today, for those of you that are members of the Lord's church, It's a holy place. Your prayers are heard. And of course, we know that when our prayers are heard, it doesn't mean that God's going to answer our prayers, you know, how we want them to be done. Sometimes I think we end our prayers without saying it. My will be done. You know, we ask as if God's our genie. Whatever our request is, my will be done. And then, you know, God, because he's our genie, is going to grant our wish. It doesn't work that way. He hears our prayers and he answers according to his will. There's no way of knowing this, but I wonder how many of my prayers have been answered negatively versus positively. There's been a lot that did not go the way I wanted. And in the end, after I realized what was happening, I was glad. Because if it had gone my way, it would have been worse. So God knows best, and especially in a heightened level like this. This is the house of the Lord, and he talks about it in an eternal sense. And yet, it was just a temporary building made of stone. I want to read the rest, just a few more verses here. Verse 13, if I shut up heaven and there be no rain, we can personalize that. Sometimes, you know, God shuts us up and we have a dry spell in our life. He's maybe trying to prove something to us or help us in one way or another. Or if I command the locusts to devour the land. Or if I send pestilence among my people. We've heard this verse 14 a lot, or I've seen it a lot this year with everything that's going on. And if I hear the phrase, these trying times, one more time, I'm going to get sick. there are so many different phrases that I'm just so sick of. Yeah, all of them. I hate them. But we see this, and it's applied to the United States of America. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. And we hear that America needs to repent. America needs to get on its knees and pray to God and repent. And I disagree with that. I don't think America is the house of God. I don't think America are the chosen people of God. I don't think America stands as the lighthouse in the world of God. And because of the sins we've allowed into our nation, God's judging us right now. I don't believe any of that. What I do believe, though, is let's just keep it with America. If every true Christian in America would do that, if the churches would do that, it would have an impact. I think part of the problem in in America now is, you know, we can blame it on society, the way society goes, but let's be honest. The church, in a lot of ways, and the church collectively, those that represent the Lord's church, a lot of them, maybe even us, have lost our savor, have lost our light. It's dimmed at best. It needs to shine brightly, especially now. So if the churches repent, if the people of God repent and start doing what they do, it could have a more positive impact. But what are we hoping for? Are we hoping for things to continue? Maybe United States kind of shift back to where it was 40 years ago? I don't want that. I don't want to go back in time. I want to go forward, looking forward to the return of Christ. So that's my prayer. If I want America to be successful only so that the churches can be successful. But no matter what happens in America or in the world, the church still has its command from God to be a light and to be this temple that is in this world. And it's an everlasting temple. It cannot be destroyed. Jesus himself said, as you heard me say many times the last couple of months, the Lord will be with his people until he returns. The gates of hell will not prevail. We have that assurance. Okay, so back in chapter 15 in Revelation. We only have a few verses left. Where did Revelation go? Okay, so verse 6, the seven angels came out of the temple having the seven plagues, clothed in pure and white linen, having their breasts girded with golden girdles. And one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials full of the wrath of God who lives forever and ever. And the temple was filled with smoke, and the glory of God and from his power, and no man was able to enter into the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were fulfilled. So this is God's judgment on the world. Where this fits in with the other prophecies we read in the Old Testament, some places in the New Testament, the judgment of the nations and all of that, this is a unique event at the return of Christ, where soon after he judges the world. And we know that that judgment is going to be very severe. God is not happy with man. Man has collectively turned away from anything spiritual. They've adopted all things unrighteous. Their whole existence is given over to anti-biblical, ungodly things. And God's going to judge. And it won't be pretty. It won't be a happy time. So with that, next month, we're going to get into chapter 16. I'm looking forward to getting into chapter 17. We're kind of going back and forth now again with God's judgment of the spiritual, in the spiritual sense, with Satan and what he calls, well, it's referred to as Babylon the Great, which is, the Bible calls her, that religious system. In fact, I think it's more than just a religious system. I think it's an all-encompassing system of evil. The beast calls her, that system, the great whore. That's how God sees it. So does anybody have any comments tonight or thoughts? Mr. Bellary. I don't know. I don't think in here, in chapter 15, it doesn't really give us a time frame of these things. I don't think that's really John's purpose. We might be able to look at some other passages with where the timeline is a little bit more real and figure this out. Like, are you thinking the Battle of Armageddon and that sort of thing? I don't know where this actually falls in with that. Really, all this references is the angels given a directive to pour out the wrath of God on the earth. And it will be a judgment that's, you know, probably comes about with some natural things, well, supernatural, like the heavens, you know, with earthquakes and all the things that are going to be happening to the earth itself. But then it also says in one place that the saints are going to help judge the world. That's part of what we're going to do is judge the world. Of course, by his directive. So this account doesn't really address the timeline specifically.
And when it says, and they will not be able to enter the temple, that's the same then as in what we just read in the Old Testament.
I think it's a similar thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. At this point, it doesn't seem like the temple is set up on earth yet. It's still in the heavens. Mm-hmm. At least that's the image I get. So... that was my thought. That's a similar event to with Solomon's temple. Anything else, Brother Ralph?
The way I interpret this is that we're reading that things are going to happen after the bride is taken up to the north. This is all happening up there.
Yeah.
With God and His church. The temple is not in the earth.
Right.
Okay, when it's on verse 5, after these things, I looked and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was open.
Right.
So the saints are already there, and then God's getting ready to pour down the wrath on the existing people that are still on earth.
Right.
Which, and there's still a lot of saint people here.
Yep.
And but this wrath is not going to affect the saved people. It's only going to affect the unsaved. Do you interpret it that way too?
I don't know how. I mean, I don't know any verse that would say one way or another. I think the whole world's going to face the wrath of God.
Right.
I mean, even if it means for a saved person who is at this time, if they die as part of God's judgment, we see that happening throughout history.
Yeah.
I mean, we even mentioned just briefly Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts. They lied to the church and God judged them, and they dropped dead right there. So I don't know if, I don't think there's going to be an immunity necessarily of the saved, because with the saved that are still there, they're the ones that it seems to me, and this, I've kind of had a different view of things since we talked about the mark of the beast. I think there are going to be some saved people who give themselves over to the flesh and are following after the course of this world rather than what they should be doing spiritually, following after God. And I think there's going to be judgment for that. So to answer your question, I don't know if there's any way we can see one way or another if there's going to be an immunity for children of God at that time.
Well, the reason I'm thinking that is because, when Moses when God delivered Egypt, after the 10 plagues, all those plagues were for the people that were
right.
That were God's people. It didn't affect any of God's people. They put the blood on the doorpost, and they were saved. I mean, they were secured.
Right.
And as far as everything else that happened, they weren't affected by any of this.
Yeah.
And God watched over them.
Yeah, I agree with that. And my response to that is that those people were God's covenant people, and they were immune from all 10 plagues. They were immune from, and they did apply the blood, and their children were spared, their flocks were spared, the firstborn. But with that, we can't say that that they represent all the saved people. They represent the chosen of God. And in the end here, the chosen of God are taken out of the world. And now God's pouring out his wrath. And I guess, unfortunately, for those that chose to live a life for the flesh rather than in the spirit, if they remain after that time and are going to face it, they will have to face the wrath of God. I mean, and whether or not they do it in this flesh, they're going to stand before God in the resurrection and give an account and face God. So I see your point. In this case here, I don't know if that's going to be up to God. What I do know is this. I don't want to risk it. I don't want to be here trusting just the fact that I'm born again and just hang everything in my eternity on that and not worry about following him. I think we need to worry about following the Lord. Then we know we won't face this. So it's too risky for me. I don't want to take a chance. Sister Alyssa, was your hand up? Oh, I thought it was. Anybody else? Sister Jody. Yeah, it certainly seems like it. Anything else? Yes.
I do agree.
1 second, Brother Renee. You know what's funny? And really quick, Brother Nick, if I don't get my thought out, I'll forget it. But I listen to the radio, and people who aren't even religious are noticing a clear difference just in spirit. Things are not the same. I can put a definite timeline on it. I can. March 15th, this year. I'm serious. When I saw on the Sports Center or whatever I was watching, when they decided to cancel all the NBA basketball games indefinitely, I thought, okay, that's an overreaction. That's a big stretch, because the numbers they were presenting to us didn't add up to the reaction. And then 2 days later, on the 17th, everything shut down. All the businesses closed. You had to figure out if you're essential or not. And I thought, man, there's something wrong here. It just doesn't make any sense. But people who don't have a spiritual mindset are noticing it. And there's a guy named Dennis Prager. I've talked about him before. He's a conservative Jew, which is very rare. He does a talk show. He even talked about how if you watch some, I'm not going to mention any names, but if you watch some of our leaders talk in Senate, in Congress, it's almost like they're, what's the word he used? Diabolical? Filled with Satan. They're evil people. And there's a difference between being wrong or making mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. Legislators make mistakes. But what they're doing is not a mistake. It's evil, is what it is. And that to me is why I'm kind of in a wonder is, you know, there's something going on behind the scenes that seems to be controlling everything. Okay, Brother Renee, go ahead.
Yeah, it was just going along the lines of verse 8, chapter 15, we talked about the glory of the Lord filling his the temple and all that, and no one can go inside and do their thing, or no man.
Yeah.
And also, you're kind of my study for the famine study on Mondays, it's on the glory. I've been doing this, that's like a three-part lesson so far. And I was reading, and you read one of my verses, so people are going to get a double blessing on Monday. So, so you know, he talked about how Solomon, he dedicated the temple. Same thing there. The glory of the Lord came down. Nobody was able to enter into the temple at the time.
Right.
And we'll go back even further when Moses had the tabernacle. And then when when the Lord did that with the cloud of his glory, it also says there, Moses went out, or any man was able to enter into the tabernacle. So it stands to reason is the glory of the Lord obviously, you know, fills these structures, and obviously man, you know, their state of mind or their limited, you know, being, you know, they just can go into where the glory of the Lord is, you know, because they have no glorified bodies, and they would just be consumed up. So like in verse 8, it talked about it's until the seven plagues and the seven angels were completed. As I think it's more so that until the glory of the Lord is either subdued or just. I mean, let me ask you this. I mean, as far as is it more of the point I'm making is the glory of the Lord, right? That keeps that temple instead of actually these plagues and all that stuff being completed. It's more of that, correct?
It seems like it. But it seems like there's more that has to be done before the temple is actually, you know, we're able to go into the temple in this glorious sense. There's still some work to be done.
Is it still being this priestly line that goes into that temple?
Well, I think that includes us. I think that includes this church.
So we're going to be the priests then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And I think at that time, I think the Old Testament priesthood was really more or less symbolic. There was a clear distinction physically between who could go in and who couldn't.
Right.
But I think those Old Testament saints, even those that weren't priests, are going to be in the same position that all are going to share in the Bride of Christ.
Yeah.
God may have his distinctions. That's up to him. But I think there'll be sort of a, you know, everybody will have that ability who has dedicated themselves to him. You know, there's one thing also. I need to look where it's at. But there's an account in the Old Testament where the glory departs the temple. The glory leaves the temple. And the word for that is Ichabod. And the light goes out. And when that happens, and there's been dark times in Israel's history where the glory of God was not there. And there was no feel, no presence of the Spirit of God. And I think in Jesus' day, when he came, he saw the money changers and the merchandise that was being exchanged there. The glory wasn't there. The glory now was in him, who he was the real temple. But something had changed. And Israel was not the spiritual nation that it should have been, even when Christ came. So, Sister Jody, was your hand up?
No.
Oh. Were you smacking one of your kids? Okay. Anything else? Yes.
There's a rabbi who, actually, I've noticed lately too that there's a bunch of rabbis that
hidden codes and hidden messages, and you know, and they always correlate with what's going on, like with the virus, especially, and saying this is our time, and they're using this like as a reason to build a temple, and you know, this is our time for the Messiah to return, and this whole COVID is because of God. God placed this here, and now the world needs to return, and all of these rabbis keep popping up, and so that is something that's like interesting that you never. Before, so, I mean, I've always followed like Israel news, but lately it's just like, who is this like Rabbi Shlomo? And like, it's like
Shlomo.
His name is Shlomo. And then and he's like, yeah, he's coming. I'm like, what is this? But you can see it. It's so they notice something's happening. They're trying to make sense of it, whatever. Of course, we have the but I just find it interesting that they're always.
I've got a hidden code for them in the New Testament, John chapter 3. They need to read John chapter 3. Yeah, it's interesting. I think COVID seems to be like the missing link to all this. I don't know how.
The whole world.
But there's a I heard a phrase recently. I'm hearing it more often now. It's called the global reset.
Yes.
The global reset, and how the world has always been trying to unite, but the one piece that wasn't going along with it was America. And the one person recently that was standing in the way was President Trump. And according to this conspiracy theory, I guess it is that the whole world now came together to try to use this to get Trump out of office. That seems kind of far-fetched to me. I don't think man's smart enough to do that. But Satan is. Satan can do that. So I don't know. Brother Ralph.
Well, I agree with you. The things that are happening all over the world, but especially here in the United States, I can see that we're losing our freedom. We're losing, you know, this constitution that we have, and you see the two parties, you know, fighting with each other and everything, and there's no more compromise on any side, and things are not working the way they should be. There's a lot of fraud going on in our democracy that we have, and it's out of control. And so I don't know if we'll be able to go back to the way it was before, because these parties are not, you know, and something's really going on that we can't.
I know exactly what it is. I'm not joking either. We will never have another conservative president. And what America needed for the past 244 years was a balance between liberal and conservative to keep each other in check from going too far one way or the other. There was always a pendulum swing where if it goes too far left, it'll come back right. If it goes too far right, it'll come back left and pretty much stay in the center. And that's healthy, that's good. I said this before in a message, I'm more conservative thinking than I am liberal, but I appreciate liberal people's point of view because it helps keep things in check. The problem is not with conservative or liberal, the problem is with leftism. Leftism is basically a removal of anything that has to do with God. We see it manifest. I'm not gonna say anymore as I'm preaching my sermon for Sunday. But that is what's driving this, is the leftism. And it's extreme anti-God, unrighteous movement. And I really don't think there's any way back. I think it's gone too far. Anything else?
Just like one small comment. I think it's like overall, they're like, the overall thing is like this, it's getting to a point where there's, I guess, the world on that aspect is trying to get rid of shame. And I think that's why it's so apparent or real to us now, because we can see the acts of the world have been increasing.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to shun shame away. Let themselves be themselves. Let sin be itself. You know? That's just a type
of... Okay, I don't get really political, but I was watching the news the other day, CNN. Don't judge me. But they were talking about COVID and the number of daily people who are getting it daily. What's the word?
New cases.
Yeah, new cases. That's completely irrelevant. It doesn't matter. But they were saying with such pity and this pathetic voice on how sad it is. And I'm thinking, what would be really nice is if they would do the same, not false, but in genuine emotion over the number of babies that are killed on a daily basis that are legalized murder by our country. That would show a complete shift in the right way. But this isn't about saving lives. They don't care about human lives. That's obvious. Okay, that was my little rant. Anything else? If not, thank you all for coming. Thank you for joining us. Oh, Sister Dolores, anything you want to add? I'm trying to turn you up so we can hear you. Okay. Anyway, thank you for tuning in. Thank you, Hernandezes. Thank you for those that are watching on YouTube Live. And God bless you all. That's it. That's all I got.